ISLO per se is unconstitutional.
It is necessary in Karnataka and has been done.
So you clearly have no data for the assertions that you're making.
So doesn't this put a person's right to be with their partner in the hands of a tehsildar?
These laws are also being brought in to legalize hatred, to legalize bigotry. That's something which is the major challenge. Therefore, there's a need that these laws need to go.
Hello to everyone. I'm Dhanya Rajendran. Joining me is my colleague Sayukta Dharmadhikari. Today, we are in conversation with Dr. Vaman Acharya of the BJP and senior lawyer B.T. Venkatesh. We are going to be talking about Karnataka's new anti-conversion bill. It's a controversial bill. Karnataka has introduced the bill in the assembly, and on Friday and Thursday, there will be debates in the assembly. It's called Karnataka Protection of Right to Freedom of Religion Bill. It's a problematic bill, as many people have said, that there are similar bills in Gujarat, Madhya Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh, and many other states. This bill specifically has got provisions which has already been stayed by the Gujarat High Court as a violation to right to life. I'm going to ask my colleague Sayukta, who has been following the story very closely, to just give us a brief of this bill.
So the Karnataka Protection of Right to Freedom of Religion Bill 2021 was tabled in the assembly on Monday. And what it says is that it will penalize anybody who attempts to convert or converts by force, by fraudulent means, by coercion, or by the promise of marriage. So, and there is a very stringent punishment in place for such an offense. This is even more stringent than the law that we have seen in Uttar Pradesh. The basic minimum sentence in this under this law is about 3 to 5 years. But in case the person who has been converted belongs to the SC or ST community, is a woman or is a minor, the punishment is more. It is up to 3 to 10 years with a fine of ₹25,000.
So I'm going to go to Mr. B.T. Venkatesh. Sir, you have read the bill. What is your first takeaway about the bill?
This law per se is unconstitutional in the construct, and it smacks on the system. And I keep telling this quite some time. I do not know why this state always hates this fundamental freedoms. It's always that's the way state looks at. State also wants freedoms to be taken away from people. That's one of the major challenges that we see on regular basis. This has been one of the major issues in the courts too for decades on, that the state always tries to take away the fundamental freedoms, restrict the fundamental freedoms, and look at the kind of laws that have come in last couple of decades, whether it is unlawful port act, whether it is TADA, whether it is unlawful actors prevention act, you name the list of them. Many of these laws really go on to the root of the denying the constitutional rights to a citizen. And in fact, the people are made more and more vulnerable by these issues. Now, given the kind of situation that we are living in this country, the kind of challenges of unemployment, challenges faced, series of challenges that have been faced by this country, including COVID and the aftermath, wherein millions of people have lost their employment, is there a need to come with some kind of laws and try to divert the attention of the people to the core issues? And that seems to be the whole process at one part.
Mr. Vaman Acharya, what Mr. B.T. Venkatesh is saying is that this bill is simply to take away rights of the people. There is no need for this bill now. It is to take away the rights of the people. How do you respond to that?
Well, whether it is as per constitution or not, somebody is, and especially these missionaries and Muslim organizations, are bound to go to court. The higher courts will decide whether it is constitutional or otherwise. We had asked Law Commission of Karnataka on this issue, where learned law people are there. They have advised and given the procedure. The same law was first passed in Madhya Pradesh in 1967, long back. Then after that, it was also done so in Uttar Pradesh, in Orissa, where never BJP government was there, as well in Gujarat and many other states, nowhere it has been struck down, which means precisely that it is constitutionally valid and it's not void. This is number one. Number two is, was there a necessity when question of food and such things, COVID are there? See, COVID was successfully handled by the government. The whole world has appreciated it. And the second question was about food and shelter and living. If human society cannot live only on food and shelter, it has higher aspirations to live. And one of the aspirations is to live peacefully without creating social disturbances. Basically, this law does not prevent anybody from converting to any other religion. The bill itself is said that it is protection of the rights of the people to follow their religion. So, if anybody, suppose there are Christians and Muslims, they can continue to enjoy the freedom of their religion that is given by constitution. We have not come in the way of their freedom. Next, why this particular issue was necessitated? Basically this was triggered by one of our MLA coming and crying in Vidhan Sabha that my own mother, without anybody's consent, has been converted and I have practically lost touch with my mother. He cried. And he is from a scheduled group. These things, he said, are happening so regularly in my district. That was Chitradurga in Karnataka district. So he insisted that something has to be done in Karnataka. This is only a precipitating issue. But before this also, the statistics show that in 1951 census, the number of Christians that were there in India was 0.08. That was less than 1%. Today, as per their own statistics, census says that more than 2.8% of the people have got converted to Christianity. This is official. Now, think about the unofficial thing. Many of the people don't change this change of religion into the documents because they get other benefits of reservations and jobs, such things. So they don't change and they don't announce. They continue to be Hindus as far as documents are concerned. But the present study by government of Karnataka shows that it is more than 3% now. So from 2.8, it is more than 3%. So this is happening unabated. Continuously this is happening. If this happens, this creates social disorder, social uncertainty. So mother has become Christian, son is Hindu, they can't live together. There are many problems. That's why Gandhi and even Savarkar had said that change of religion is change of nationalism.
I want to interrupt you on various points that you've made. Sayukta, you have something to ask. I see you're bursting to ask.
Please.
Yes, sir. Sir, you have said that none of these laws in Gujarat were stayed by the were struck down by the High Court. But a part of the original 2003 law that the Gujarat government had brought, that portions of that are still there in the Karnataka law have been struck down there by the Gujarat High Court, saying that they are violative of an individual's freedom to practice religion. And it also jeopardizes a lot of interfaith marriages, because now in Karnataka there is a lengthy process of application for conversion. And even promise by marriage, if you convert, say thinking that, okay, I'm going to get married to this person, and if the person converts, even that can be illegal, and just anybody can, complain against this. Don't you think all of these issues, did the Law Commission in Karnataka go over the parts that were stayed by the Gujarat High Court and, sort of try and tighten the Karnataka law? Did that happen? And well, it's not that you, why
you mentioned about you mentioned about that the relations will be jeopardized. See, the this culture, Indian culture, has been almost 10,000 years old. You are changing it within a minute, without notice, without being documented anywhere. Why it is happening? Who has done it? Who is doing? What is the purpose? You don't want to have anything and just want to change the religion. This is the exact cause.
So just to interrupt you, the question to you is that you had said that none of these laws have been struck down by any courts, which is not true. The Gujarat High Court has stayed certain sections of it. Why does the Karnataka government repeat the same provisions in this new law? I mean, one High Court has already called it violation of life. Why has that been repeated? Here is the question.
We have Karnataka High Court. Let us wait and see. We have found that what Gujarat High Court has done is questionable. And there also, they may go to Supreme Court. Karnataka will insist that this is as per constitution. There in Indian independence, independence to law, independence to opinion, freedom, you can go to any court and challenge. But presently, it was found that it is necessary in Karnataka and has been done. And we'll follow it up and see that whatever change is needed, because that is also part of the amendment they have we have brought. If any changes are needed to make the law reach the level at which it should reach, means to the common man, we will make changes in the law. If High Court suggests few things, we'll follow them and see that this law is implemented properly as per constitution.
So I
you
also
need not worry what High Court of Gujarat has said.
Yes, I also want to ask you about two data points which you said in your answer. First, you talked about the census from 1951 to 2000, the last census where the Muslim
2011,
population...
2011.
Now, between 1951 and 2011, the Hindu population grew from 30.4 crores to 96.6 crores. Muslims grew from 3.5 crore to 17.2. And Christians rose from 0.8 to 2.8. So why do you use statistics sparingly? You talked about the census and the growth of Christians, but Hindus also have grown three times in India. That's my first question, sir. My second
question... I will answer this question first.
Let me ask both together because both are connected.
I will come back.
Okay.
First question, I will finish. When you talk of Christians, you agree for percentage. When you talk of Hindus, you come to absolute numbers. You think, you take one parameter.
So I said absolute numbers for all three.
If you take absolute numbers for all of the three, the number of Christians, absolute number, has definitely increased by more than 3%. Has absolutely increased. Percentage wise, when I am telling, percentage is general conception for all. How much Hindus, how much Christians, how much Muslims. It's a common thing. So I still insist that the data says, the information of the census says that number of conversions has increased and it is fraudulent.
Sir, in this data, when you say that, you know, this has been an increase, did any legal expert or any, was there any study put into how many of these were illegal as per, you know, what you would term an illegal conversion?
See, this is what exactly we want to do it now. Once the law is made, you can make whether what is legal and which is illegal. Unless there is a law, nobody knows what is happening. Whether they are doing it fraudulently, whether they are showing some sticks for them to convert, like school education, like job, like foods, like money, so many things that that could have gone into. To make a proper, we are not against Christians. We love them. It's a good society. But at the same time, those who get converted, it should be documented properly. Why you are getting converted? What is happening? Let them give a statement. A very simple statement also has been brought in Vidhan Sabha of Karnataka. It will be a regular format they have to fill up, go and submit it to the district commissioner or collector, and he will approve. We are not against even conversion. conversion has to be legal. This is the answer to your question, whether it is illegal. Illegal conversions which have been done fraudulent way have to be stopped. This is the intention. And you must get the data. Unless you have a data, I can't speak with the public. So we would have data, and the law forbids them to do it the way they want.
Mr. Vamanacharya, you are saying that there is no data now. We'll bring the law and then we'll talk about data. Is that how a law should be brought, first thing? And second, you spoke about Gullihatti Shekhar, the MLA. Now, there was a survey which your government sanctioned in Hosadurga, and the Tahsildar who did that survey clearly came and said there were no forced conversions. He went home to home and asked people. So you clearly have no data for the assertions that you're making.
Exactly. Exactly. You have answered my question. Because many of these people do not make a document at all. So no data will be available. The best data is what his own son, own born son is telling, that my mother is converted to Christianity. Do you want any other proof? This is what is exactly happening. They convert. They don't enter into any documents. This is what the new law says. You get converted. No objection. You fill up a form, submit it to Jilladhikari. He will come, Tahsildar or anybody will come, see whether it really has happened. He will certify, yes, this man has gone into Christianity or Islam. You have freedom. You have answered my question much better.
Sir, first thing I want to just point out here, that Gullihatti Shekhar's mother or anybody's mother, they have the right to profess, practice any religion they want. And Gullihatti's mother has come on camera many times, told media channels that she's going out of her own will, that there is no forced conversion there. See, this law is brought.
You are contradicting. One minute. Dhanya, you are contradicting. Just now you said that she was not converted at all.
No. I said there's no forced conversion.
No. Tahsildar has said that no conversions have happened. Just now
he said. Said no.
Now you are contradicting, saying that she has not converted on her own. Okay, let it be proved. That's what we are saying. That if she has got converted on her own, she has every right to do. Though she is the mother of BJP MLA, she has every right to get converted to any other religion. But it has not happened. So it has done because of some lure. Something that she will get out of this. So the new law does not prevent anybody from going to any other religion or coming back, but it only says that do it need. A country like ours, we did Aadhaar card for all the people. We have done so many changes in last few years. We have brought electoral cards, identity cards. So now there is a need that if anybody is doing conversions going out of our religion, let there be a document. That's all what the new law says.
Mr. Venkatesh, can you hear me now?
So, sir, you said that, you know, everybody, they have to prove whether they, there was actually a forced conversion or they went out of their way. Now, the Gujarat High Court, I know I'm citing the Gujarat High Court again, but it is a judicial, court that, upholds the valid, it knows best about the law. So in that case, the Gujarat High Court said that placing the burden of proof on individuals themselves to prove that, the marriage that they are going to go in for is not just for conversion. Don't you think that burden is too much to put on an individual who has to constantly prove that their marriage is not because of a forced conversion or an impending conversion? Doesn't it somehow put, show interfaith marriages as something that is, less convenient and more, now includes a lot of steps? So won't that sort of discourage interfaith marriages? Doesn't this law discourage people's right to choose their partner and to be in the religion that they want?
You can choose the partner you want, either male or female, but conversions have happened like love jihad. It has been a very popular thing in Kerala and even some parts of Karnataka. this should not happen. So, to make it legally systematic, documented, the burden of proving that she or he has not converted herself to some other religion just for the sake of marriage, proving this, the woman of burden, the burden of proving it lies with the person who has done this offense.
But sir, why can't a person change their religion for the sake of marriage? If somebody gets married to a Muslim or Christian and they themselves nothing want wrong. To change religion.
Nothing wrong. No. Why? We have never said. Let them change their religion. Change for anything they want. But has to be documented. Otherwise, forcing, cheating, telling wrong things, converting them, then people feeling bad. But by that time, it is late. Too late for the young girl to go and say that this all has happened. It is too late. That is the reason that make it systematic. Even in the past, before the marriages were decided, they used to take 3 months, 4 months, do several rituals because they wanted to know, they wanted to confirm which the family is, which the girl is, what are her education backgrounds. This used to be the part of the tradition of Indian community. Only after the advent of modern world, people have gone for this sudden marriages. Nothing wrong, but only make it documented. Because ours also is a civilized country. In any other country, whatever you do is documented. Tomorrow people will say that, why do you register our marriage? Not needed at all. No, they have to be documented. And if you want to get converted, nothing wrong in it. Go to any religion you want, but make it properly as per law. So a systematic law has been developed and made.
This seems like a very innocent exercise just to make people register.
It is not innocent. It is not at all innocent.
But sir, what confidence will people have
with a very clear object of bringing law and order?
Yes, sir, but I'm asking that considering the number of attacks on church halls and prayer halls in the last few months, what confidence can people have that this law will not be misused to actually bother people, to target them, to harass them?
No, nobody has attacked any churches so far. Whatever news has come, if they have any grievances, they can go to police station. And any attack on anybody, any institution is wrong. Whether it is temple or Hindu house or a Christian house or a father, they can go to police station. There have been so many attacks on Hindu community in last 1,000 years.
Sir, but let's not talk about 1,000 years. I'm talking about
what has happened.
How are you last... that there have been no attacks?
See, this is a democratic country. Mine is still a democratic country. You can go to police station. You can complain against who has done this. There is a way to handle it. Just because some people may have thrown some stones on church for doing illegal conversion, that does not mean that all things have gone wrong in this country. Everything is terrible. No, that is not the case. Still, law and order prevails. You can go to court and get the justice, irrespective of your religion.
I just have one doubt, because under the law, it says that anybody who is associated with the person who wishes to convert can, you know, file a complaint alleging illegal conversion. And then there's a long process of where the magistrate will order an inquiry, etc.
Very short.
No, why should anyone and everyone be given the independence to just complain?
I'm just giving you a scenario. Yeah, I'm just giving you a scenario.
This is a country with laws. There cannot be anarchy. Anybody walks into any religion, comes back, goes anywhere, does anything. No anarchy.
Why is the state getting into the matters of faith is one.
No, just because we want a system.
Anyone to file a complaint.
No, we want to have a system. This is not an anarchic country.
There is also a
very for a culture, especially for a culture of 10,000 years. You cannot expect anarchy that happened in last 1,000 years. In last 50 years, it should have been done. But at least now it is happening. You must be very happy. You should welcome this.
Sayukta, you were saying something?
I was also pointing out the lengthy process of registering a, you know, a valid conversion. Don't you think the magistrate putting up a notice and everything, not only does it, it will give the family of, say, for example, an interfaith couple wants to get it married, but their family is opposed to it. Won't it give more power to the family to clamp down on this interfaith relationship?
But that's the whole purpose of the law, right? That everybody can just basically complain against a consenting couple if somebody wants to. I mean, why is this law?
Does it not,
anybody can file a complaint. I don't understand that.
Does it not violate a person's freedom of choice to choose their partner, to choose their religion and their right of privacy by putting all of their details onto a notice board? Isn't that fundamental rights are being
for
broken?
For any marriages, all these things are needed. For any marriage registration, all these things, putting your all details, age, husband's name, whom you want to marry, who was
but
there presiding over the marriage ceremony, who was the
current times.
All these things are necessary even for Hindu Marriage Act and all have to be registered. This could be a long drawn process, but the new process also says this all has to be done within 30 days.
But in current times when interfaith couples are usually frowned upon and are not approved of, don't you think this bill will promote more of the, you know, it will make them more vulnerable to such targeting?
This law will bring in a system wherein anybody who wants to change the religion, a 10,000 year or even more religion that has been there in this country, if you want to change, you can't change it suddenly. You just notify to a system called government and get it recorded. Don't leave any space for suspicion, force, intimidation and money and such matters. Marriage is simple, live long, and it will be as good as Hindu marriages being registered. Nothing more than that.
So under this law, what will be considered as a valid reason for conversion? We know that there are forceful, etc., etc. What reasons will, you know, be valid if a person wants to convert?
Even marriage can be. They can marry and there could be an inter-religious marriage. Only thing is, this marriage should not be done for conversion. That has to be proved. That's all. Other things, that's what you have to give a notice to the Tashildar or DC. Tashildar will come and do basic studies, what has happened. Or a social worker will come and do basic study. And if everything is okay, nobody should come in the way of getting converted. To make it legal.
So doesn't this put a person's right to be with their partner in the hands of a tehsildar or a social worker who get
and even their own family? I mean, it's not like families allow people to marry.
This is the case even for all Hindu marriages. They have to go to sub-registrar office.
But that's not the same. That is not the same.
You have to take your photo. You have to take your marriage photo. You have to take. There is a format. You have to write in that form. Both of you should go sit there and wait in the sub-registrar office and register your marriage. Since this is a very specific case where he or she is changing her or his religion, which has been a part of the culture of this country, this should not happen all of a sudden. This gives scope to so many wrong things that may disturb the society and the family also in long run. Family means not just husband and wife. Both parents of both the sides, brothers, all these things should not be disturbed. For this reason, this law makes everything transparent, neat, documented, lawful.
Mr. B.T. Venkatesh, I hope you're finally back here.
I'm back.
Yes. If you do you want to give a
you have to leave me. This
yes, yes.
I have some other I
yes,
have some
thank
other
you very
interview.
Much.
Thank
yes,
you.
Thank you.
Thank
much.
You so much. Thank you.
Mr. B.T. Venkatesh, would you like to respond to all the things Mr. Vamanacharya said? Including the fact that this is a very there's a very non-problematic view where it just wants to make people register. if they are going to convert.
The construct is that the tone and tenor of the presentations have been, one, it's a condescending attitude. And the most horrible, dangerous construct that I see here is a very condescending attitude towards this issue. Second, we have developed as a nation. We are 75 years into independence, 72nd year into republic in just 1 month's time. And in such a nation, with the kind of law that has developed, someone coming and telling me that I should go and make an application that I want to change my faith, and someone else, state, has the authority to say, verify whether I am changing my faith on my own volition or not. And it has to go through the procedures. And the kind of procedures that happen is that anyone can raise an issue. In fact, if we were to look into the statute which we have today, anyone, not only family, even any person concerned, even a colleague, he can lodge a complaint. That is the kind of concern that we have. And I think it has very, very serious connotations regarding our personal freedom. And more construct is that, you know, while all these notions are being made a statement that there have been a law of this nature in other states, the law has been approved by the courts, all those aspects being said. Now, there is a development in the law. For example, if you look into any of these rights, you look at the Justice K.S. Putswamy's case, a 9-judge bench judgment of High Court and Supreme Court of India, it speaks very clearly of the right to privacy. Right to privacy, every section article of the Constitution has been specifically dealt with. The kind of the construct of the individual dignity is concerned is made now sacrosanct. The nature of restriction has been made so strict, the state need to come with something. Here, when I was listening, Mr. Onnachari comes to make a statement that this become an issue, that one legislator lodges a complaint and the entire law comes into structure. We have been complaining regarding hunger. We have been complaining regarding unemployment. We have been complaining on everything under the sun. I don't know how come that only this voice of the legislator is heard by the government and not the kind of hunger and misery which is faced by the people is not being heard. That's one part. The second part which you see is that one is to deviate the whole main arguments, main challenges that this state is placing, one part. And second part is that trying to make, I have been telling in the first instance, making these minorities into second class citizens. Third part, which is more important, is to, one of the reasons is that keeping this flock together among the Hindu majority. The challenge that the Hindu majority has is that it does not treat its people equally. That is a big challenge. You have the caste structure of 6,000 castes across the country out there. What exactly do you mean to communicate? That a person's choice to choose a faith, that I must get permission from the state, and more particularly, you look into the whole law, how it impacts. It impacts on minorities. It impacts on women. And women have no right. In fact, unfortunate, women have no right of voice in this particular thing. Third, the scheduled caste and the entire three forms that they have given, you have to explain whether you're a woman, whether you're scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, every aspect need to be done. And it goes to show that the burden of, we call it as reverse burden, this concept of reverse burden under the law, which is being brought into this law, it's very, very stringent. One, you look into it, reverse burden law is available in India. It's not that it's strange, it's not available. If you talk in terms of a case of rape, there is this reverse burden which is employed. You talk in terms of child sexual abuse cases, reverse burden is employed. You talk in terms of NDPS, reverse burden is employed. You talk in terms of National Investigating Agency Act cases, unlawful act of prevention, UAPA cases, reverse burden is employed. So there are certain set of laws where the gravity of the offense is so high, it impacts on the society. Now, how does this come? Somebody making a choice of the religion, how does it become so grave a law that you have to have a law which says that you can, the kind of reverse burden is employed, wherein the accused is supposed to prove that he is innocent, not the prosecution.
Yes, that's actually a huge problem with this bill. It basically
serious
on the person who converts and the person who converts, the converter. As it says.
So what happens is that today, look at the structure who can be employed. Individuals, educational institutions, NGOs, anyone, it's the broad spectrum of everyone available. And the allurement, definition of allurement can be anything under the law. And for example,
including free education.
Yeah.
For example, free education. And gift. He was giving a statement that of the minuscule population of Christianity has increased by meets and bounds. Let me tell you one thing. Christianity has been in India almost for 1,500 years. Islam is in India for more than 1,300 years, right? From almost within some 100 years of its coming into existence, it had reached the coast of Kerala. That's the reality we know. Now, how do you say that they have been, in fact, there is accusations they have been converting 1,300 years, and best part of last 1,000 years, Muslim rulers have been ruling this country, right? From the slave dynasty to Mughals, they virtually ruled large part of India. So the construct that we have in all this period, was it not possible for them to convert en masse all this population? That hasn't happened. Despite the rule for such a long time, there's still a minority in this particular country. Then you look into the British's hold there for the last 200 years. Such amount of control they had, the kind of changes that brought in, the kind of power which they employed, even killing kings, moving them off, taking away the governments, the kind of thing which they did not have the power to convert the people into Christianity. They continue to be in such a minuscule population even as on this day. Majority, where is this threat coming in? It's a predominantly something which is being pushed down the throat of the majority. And it's the kind of thing, it's happening not today. This is being said for ages by RSS and its cohorts that we become a minority. How can this population become a minority in this country at all? Impossible. It is the next impossibility. The kind of false statements which have been made throughout are being pushed through. It's like, you know, a Goebbelsian theory. We keep on telling a lie all the time and we become a truth. And that seems to be the method employed by the thing. And this particular law is towards that. And unfortunately,
including, if I can just interrupt, including the BJP spokesperson is not here, but he started with no attacks happened in churches or church halls to maybe somebody has thrown stones because there was some illegal conversion. So in the conversation itself, he took two stands.
And let me tell you one thing. There was just received in the afternoon an RTA information from the government of Karnataka that no forcible conversion have taken place in the state of Karnataka till date. Where is this threat? What exactly they are talking about? It's their own statement. It's not my statement. It's the RTA report which has come. And it is informed that no forcible conversion has taken place in Karnataka.
So that is what he said, that, you know, we don't have the data, but we are bringing in the bill to ensure that, you know, to find that data.
Make a law. You can't bring in a law on the basis of some perception of an individual imaginary without a fact. We live in a law state which believes in rule of law. You need to understand that. Any statute that need to come into existence, that need to be put into place for debate, discussion, opportunity to be given to the people to come up with their suggestions. I don't know how this happens these days. In that, whether it is relating to the statutes that we had earlier, we had come up in, whether it is POCSO, whether it is Juvenile Justice Act, whether it is the
Protection of Women from Domestic Violence Act, the POSH Act, Sexual Harassment at Workplace Act. In each of these statutes, the Parliament had issued publication of this proposed bill, served it across the country, sufficient time for all of us to intervene. In all these cases, groups and organizations which I support had filed their affidavits, had made the representation, had in fact gone to the before the standing committee, given their testimony. At length, they have given their testimony. After all those things, the standing committee makes all those changes and presents it to the parliament. Now, that's called a legislative process. In fact, any democratic country which talks in terms of the legislative process, we have something called, you look at the House of Commons, first reading, second reading, third reading. It's only after the third reading which is done, which is tabled before the parliament. It's only then in the House of Commons the discussion happens. Similar is the pattern that is employed in the Indian legislative process, parliamentary processes. And but now these days, it just comes in a flash. It comes in a flash and presents it to the assembly, such laws being made. In fact, very strange, until 48 hours ago, people did not have the access to this particular law. In fact, it was Dhanya who shared a copy to me, a photograph image which he sent to me. I had to convert that into printout and convert it into a PDF and share it with friends to say that this is the kind of law that's being brought into force. And how could this happen? That we are in a state where the impunity of the state to bring in legislation, trying to push through legislation without there being any kind of information to the people. And such law. And unfortunately, large sections of the society are being affected. Who are affected? It's not just, it's being projected as it's going to impact, the whole notion is going to impact the Christians, it's going to impact the Muslims, it's going to impact the minorities. I'm sorry, it's going to impact Lingayats. I'm sorry, it's going to impact large section of Hindus, more particularly Dalits. So they would like to see that these communities don't get that space. The question of conversion in this India, right from Ambedkar, is that I'm a born Hindu, but I would not like to die a Hindu. Where this comes from, why this anger, frustration comes from? And this comes from the construct that the way they treat the communities. So they move out. Their moving out is not because that somebody allured them. There's an allurement. It's because of self-respect. In fact, if you look into the movement of Periyar in Tamil Nadu, it's self-respect. That I have an existence. So people move out. You look at Meenakshipuram incident. People have believe in self-respect. It's not possible for us to survive in a state.
No, I think I'll wind up now, that's why. And I wish, I really wish that you were on air while Mr. Vamanacharya was that's there, because many of his points could have been contested, but internet works in strange ways. Anyway, just to sum up, what you're saying is that this bill, this law is simply to legalize hatred, to legalize bigotry. There was no need for such a law. There's a fear being created. It's an unfounded fear and a law on the base of that fear. So with that, we will close the discussion.
Making this community second-class citizen. That's one of the whole thing that which is condescending attitude, and make these communities that they are second-class citizen. They need to go according to the terms. In fact, the forms, three forms, if we were to read with this law, demonstrate an absolute. The intention is very clear in the definitions. Intention is very clear in the three forms. Yeah, that speaks.
Intention is very clear, says Mr. B.T. Venkatesh. Of course, if Mr. Vamanacharya was there, he would have contested it. Thank you very much for joining Sayukta and me in this discussion, sir. Looking forward for more such discussions. Thank you.
Thank you. We're also looking at News Minute come with much more views. It's better. In fact, I've been informing friends that it's come with wonderful story. There are 10 points on this law, which has been done so beautiful. I think we shared it.
Sayukta Dharmadhikari, who's sitting there. Yes.
Yeah, he was so good. It was such a joy to read. And I've been sharing with large number of our groups and reach lawyer. We have large number of these broadcast lists, and we shared with each one of them to see that people have been informed over this particular law. There is a requirement of dissemination of information and discussions and debates on any of this law that makes this democracy vibrant. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, Sayukta. Thank you.